was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. It's when you call my name my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old me knew Jesus when I met you. It's when you call my name and I ran out of that grave. I needed rescue, my sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Alone in my sorrow and in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made chain, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, your endless love pouring down on us. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. Oh, yes, it does. A savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced, so heaven had lost. But when Jesus arose in the freedom in hand, that's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Heavenly Father, today is a glorious day. It's a glorious day because we're here together as a church worshiping you, Lord. Lord, just help us listen to you today. Guide our hearts and our minds as we take you in, Lord, and better our relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray.
child is white, the whole world looks upon a sight, a beautiful sight.
Good morning, Crossroads family, and anyone who might be tuning in this morning. It is my pleasure to be sitting around this table talking about race relationships and wrapping up the series that we've been doing for a while called Won't You Be My Neighbor. And so to my far left is Pastor James Fielder.
Good morning.
I'll let you talk a little bit about your endeavors here, but he is currently the pastor of a new church plant called Church of the Way in Champaign, right?
Yes.
Okay. And Pastor Holden Smith is to my left. My name is Randy Henshaw, pastor here at Crossroads. And Pastor Irvin, yes. And I want to say Williams.
Good morning.
Yeah. Man, I drew a blank for a second. He is the director at Restoration Urban Ministries in Champaign, and I had the privilege of meeting him a few weeks ago. And sometimes in life you feel like you have stopped at a divine appointment, and that's how I felt when I met Irvin. So I'm just excited to have these guys at this table as we wrap up the series. Last week, Pastor James talked about, what is one of the solutions to this whole issue. And one of them is to make coffee. So we made coffee today, and we've got coffee. And so if anybody is inclined, I guess we're all inclined, we'll have a sip. But this is just symbolic about coming together with your brothers who disagree with you, who may seem as far from you as they can get, and coming around a table together to get to know each other, to listen, and to connect. And that's really the whole purpose of what we're trying to accomplish. So I just have a couple of questions that I want to ask these guys. I mostly want to hear from Irvin and James, but both of you separately, and I think we've talked about it together, you use the phrase that you grew up in the hood. And so I thought it would be interesting to first start with Holden, because Holden grew up in the hood. What was your growing up in the hood, because your experience like?
So yeah, I grew up small town Edinburgh, surrounded by cornfields. You spit any direction, you hit the town border kind of scenario. Population 1,200, but it was kind of an inside joke of the town that we lied about the population so we could hire a police officer. And it was one of those jokes we all kind of went, ha ha ha, but deep down we all thought was pretty true. So that was kind of my experience. You know, it was a small town, very little diversity, mostly farm families or families that was bedroom community for, say, Springfield or Taylorville, where there's more opportunity for jobs. And that was kind of, that was my experience.
Well, my hood was Marshall, Indiana, and it was 1/4 the size of your town.
Oh, wow.
300 people, and I think we counted dogs and cats. But what I remember about growing up in Marshall, Indiana, just one thing, and I do want to hear from you guys a little more extensively on this, is that no one ever lost their car keys. And the reason no one ever lost their car keys is because they left them in their ignition. I mean, left your keys in your car.
Yeah.
Houses weren't locked. Cars weren't locked. I don't know if businesses were locked. It was just not a thing. And so when I hear you guys talk about growing up in the hood, I just immediately know that it's a different kind of experience than what I had growing up as a kid. So what are some of the things that I guess I would say that you experienced, start with you, James, that that shaped you and are kind of profound memories of your childhood growing up?
Well, I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri. Born February 14th, 1962. Some of the neighborhoods I remember living at, Martin Luther King and Jefferson. And if you know anything about a city, and if it's Martin Luther King Avenue or Boulevard, there were no peace rallies going on. That's the black neighborhood.
Yeah.
What I remember, though, is that we were poor, but we didn't know we were poor. We lived off of food stamps, or, you know, we called the government cheese or whatever, but we didn't know that was poor. We make up games because we didn't have we make up a game called Mama Pig, where you take a knife and you flip it certain ways, and that's a game. Hopscotch, where you draw stuff on the ground and the girls would play hopscotch. Well, we made up stuff. but we all kind of had each other's back. So it was like we didn't have a lot of stuff. We'd have things like rent parties. You know what a rent party is? So a rent party is, if say one family can't afford to pay their rent, we throw a party. And if you play guitar, the lead guitar, and you could play horns, and you could cook, well, we're gonna all go to your house, and people pay an entrance fee, and that's how we make sure your rent was taken care of that month. And so that was the hood. Now I was, God bless me, to be somewhat smart. And so I was a little smart kid in the hood that people left alone because I could do their homework. And so nobody would beat me up. I mean, there was stuff like that, fights or whatever. So they just leave James alone, Jimmy, alone. We don't speak of this after this, right? They wouldn't mess with me because I could take care of people's homework. I was somewhat intelligent. I read a lot of things like that. Eventually, I ended up at a private high school. One of my junior high principal saw my potential, and he had a relationship with the private school in the rich hood. So when you talk about being shaped, so I was going from total black neighborhood, grade schools were not well funded, to taking a bus, we called it Bi-State Going Your Way, from downtown Martin Luther King Avenue out to the rich neighborhood. So my worlds were now split, like, okay. What I learned in that space, because initially I was somewhat intimidated. I didn't like being out there because I'm like, this is all white kids, and then I'm going to the black neighborhood, and I go to the white neighborhood. The first time me hearing a white person use the N-word was at that school.
Wow.
At 13 years old. Mm-hmm. From one of my classmates, and he just kind of laughed it off. The first fight I got into in staying in high school was there. It wasn't in the hood, it was there, because I'm like, didn't know how to defend myself.
Mm-hmm.
But what I figured out is how to compete academically. I figured out that I was that this little black kid that lived in the hood was just as intelligent as the white children that, you know, their dads were CEOs. I mean, this was a great school. I went on an academic scholarship. Me learning that I could compete, I'm saying compete, but I could be successful in this space. And I wasn't a great athlete. Some of the kids got athletic scholarships. I just had my intellect. When I think of how it shaped me in life to where I'm at now as a pastor, and where I've been throughout the world, because I've been in the Marine Corps multicultural space, I'm competing. I've been in technology industry, I'm one of very few black people, but I'm competing. And now I'm a pastor, or have been a pastor in an all-white town. It shifted from competing to where I feel like I'm not just good enough, but now I'm peers. So God kind of orchestrated that walk at a young age that I could take some of the language, I don't have to respond in anger. I respond with my intellect and my skill.
Great. Thank you so much for sharing that. Urban, you had quite a time growing up. And if you don't mind sharing some of your story, we'd love to hear it.
Well, for one thing, Brother James, I grew up in his backyard. So I'm from south of St. Louis, called Cape Girardeau, Missouri, right on the Mississippi River. Little German town. It was pretty well divided. We had what they had an area called Smelterville, where pretty much all black, low income. And so I grew up pretty much in an integrated neighborhood, but these were the rejects and these were the people that was all sort of pushing. I like to use the word colonized there, because they didn't offer or didn't have jobs. They didn't have none of the money. They didn't have any of the things that the rest of the community had, so they all kind of ended up there. So we had white, black, we had some Native Americans, and we also had some Hispanics or Puerto Ricans that was actually living there with us. So we grew up there, and we never knew what poverty was. Until I went to high school, I really didn't understand any of that, because we were all the same. And And I grew up in the 50s, so a lot of the things were, you know, people, it wasn't subtle. People were very overt and said what they said. You know, it was no big thing for me growing up. If a white guy saw me, an older guy, and didn't know me, my name was Willie. So, hey, Willie, come here. And so everyone's name was Willie. So as we grew up, and of course the N-word was there. First time I really got exposed to that was when I went to school. The only thing I ever wanted to do, I had an uncle that had studied in college. He wanted to be a doctor. He didn't. He went into the service and stayed there. But he left all of his books. So I got an opportunity. I would thumb through those pages and I would look at his books and I thought, this is what I want to be. This is what I want to be. I want to be a doctor. I'd watch the older kids get on the school bus and drive out. And they'd have their little greasy sacks where they had their lunch in. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't wait to go to school so I can get me a little greasy sack too, you know, and go. And every day I'd see them go and I couldn't wait. And finally I got old enough where I got to go to school and I got my little greasy bag. And I remember the first day I got on the bus, I was just so happy. And I got in there. And my mom had already taught me how to read and write before I started school. And I was just so happy to be sitting in there. You know, I'm at school now, you know, with the big kids. And I remember needing to go to the restroom. And the teacher, in those days, you only had one teacher to a class. You didn't have aides or anything. And I remember very, very clearly, teacher explaining to me how to go to the restroom. He says, go down there. When you get to the end of it, you see there's a rope. Make a turn. Count doors. 1, 2. Go in there. Use the restroom. I did exactly what she told me. Went in. Counted doors. Went inside the restroom. Counted. Saw. Looked around. I saw these porcelain things that I had no idea what they were. Mm. So I came back. And then I decided to go all the way down in the hall. So I went down in the hall. I looked. I went outside. I couldn't find anything out there. I came back in. Managed to make my way back to the classroom. And I told her, I got to go. I got to go. She said, well, did you follow my exam? My instructions? I said, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And she says, well, just do it again. So I went back down. I did exactly what she told me to do. I went in. It was the same things there. And because we grew up without houses, and so I had no idea what that was. You know, I was already counting. I was already reading. I knew my ABCs. I knew those things. And I remember coming, making my way back again and tell her, and she had to lead the class. So she went down there, and she showed me to go in there and do something. So I went in there. And I didn't know whether the difference between a urinal and a commode, so I did what I needed to do. Well, later on, the report came back that there were some things in the urinal that shouldn't have been in the urinal. Mm-hmm. So she decided to just blast it before the class. We've got some really stupid people here, and they can't tell the difference between a urinal and a stool. And she goes on, and they need to be put away or something. And it hurt my feelings because all I ever wanted to do was go to school. Later on, because of the problems we were having, my mom went to the school. She talked to the principal. They wanted to move me. Well, they moved me into another first grade class. They determined that I really didn't need to be in the first grade. They needed to move me to the second grade. That never would have happened in that other class. It never would have occurred because she had her mind made up who I was. Mm-hmm. I remember because I said I wanted to be a doctor so badly that I was talking one day to one of my teachers. My grades were high. And I told her, what do you want to be when you grow up? I want to be a doctor. That's what I want to be. And she discouraged me because she told me, she says, you know, you'd probably do well as a good janitor. And not that I have anything against a janitor, but that wasn't what I wanted to be. I wanted to be a doctor. And I was determined to prove her wrong. So all the way through to high school, you know, my grades were at the top. I stayed there and I was determined I was going to be a doctor. I got into high school and now, because of my grade point average, they moved me into classes where I didn't see any of my friends. I was the only black thing in the classroom. I caught a lot of stuff from them. And what started happening, I started really feeling now I don't care for school and I don't care for people in authority and I don't care for people with white faces. Even though some of my best friends were white, these here I didn't want to have anything to do with. And as I got older and went through more things, I found myself becoming more rebellious. As we were ending the 50s, and getting into the 60s, there are a lot of more things happening now nationally about some of the inequities. And And I got involved, and I wanted to be, I realized something is wrong here. I want the right to be able to do certain things. And so that meant that I started saying things in the classroom that didn't go over very well. I said things when I wasn't allowed to go into a certain store. I try to push my way into it. There were little things I began to do to say, I'm a challenge that's on every hand. In our small town, in the hospitals there, we went to the back door. We didn't come through the front door. And then there was a certain place where coloreds had to be at versus the rest of everyone else. And so, you know, we didn't get the best medical treatment. We didn't get a lot of those things. And I protested against those. And found myself a lot of times being thrown in jail and then let out because of it. And I knew there were other people that felt the same way. But I decided this is where I am. And at a certain point, I began to make the newspaper quite a bit because I went down to city council and other places. And I just decided I'm not going to put up with any more of this. It was one night when, in the middle of all of this here, I just graduated from high school. And there was a lot of commotion. We went to the door, and there was a cross burning in the front yard. And they had, everyone had left, but there it stood. I knew what that meant. I knew there were people within our community that did not want me there, did not like me because of the color of my skin. And that sort of moved me elsewhere in Chicago, where I started dealing with a lot of Black Panthers and things. And I wasn't just per se a Black Panther. I loved their philosophy. I loved the fact that they were taking hold and they were being responsible for the community. They were the ones who were training. They were the ones who was doing the breakfast programs. They were the ones who were taking the young men and making them feel good about who they were. And I spent my, no matter how hard I tried, I never was allowed to feel good about who I am. And so I did that up until for years. And a couple other things happened, but until I went into the service, that was my life. And I thought it would be over within the service. It wasn't. It was still there. You know, and we experienced that quite a bit.
I just want to not walk away from your story without what probably I think ends up being one of the most significant moments of your life, given where you're at today. You told me in a conversation with James when we met about the cross burning, and I got so emotional imagining that scene for you, and I still feel the emotion of it now. But my question to you was, how in the world did you ever become a Christian with that happening in your life? And you That's told amazing. Me about it, Pastor Bradford.
Yeah.
Could you tell us that story about Pastor Bradford?
Well, the last thing I wanted to do was be a Christian. I'd grown up in the church. My grandmother was probably the epitome of living a Christian life. But I didn't want it because I felt like my grandmother at the time, we had a word called Uncle Tom. These were people who loved white folks and loved the system and wouldn't challenge it. So they looked upon her because my grandmother worked for the white folks. But she loved us. She did what she cared for us. But, you know, I just really fought at the idea of becoming a Christian. When I moved to Oklahoma, and I got sick, actually, and I was going through some really bad time. In fact, my stomach had literally split open. And so I ended up being in the hospital for several months trying to basically save my life. I got to the place where I could come back home. And I couldn't eat. I couldn't do a lot of things I just still couldn't do. And I just, all I wanted to do was just simply go to sleep and not wake up. They gave me Valiums like you give M&Ms. So I would constantly take these Valiums, you know, throughout the day. And all I wanted was for my wife to let me have the bottle. And I can take care of all of this. I don't have to feel this way. I don't want to live in this world any longer. But she wouldn't. And so she would give me, I'd take a couple of them and I'd roll over and go to sleep. My wife knew I didn't want to live. She went, called around. She managed to find this little Baptist preacher who come to my home. And he visited with me. I remember waking up and turning over, and there he was sitting there, and a little old guy, bald head, and I just didn't want to, you know, and he told me who he was, and I just, don't want to talk. Don't bring that up. He said, I love you. God love you. He said, Irvin, And he talked a little bit, and he says, I'll be back. And I'm thinking, don't. He left, and next day, about the same time, he showed up. And all throughout the week, he kept doing this. He kept showing up, and he kept telling me he loved me. He kept telling me Jesus loved me. And I did not want to hear that for nothing. And I remember one morning, I woke up, I turned over, expecting him to be there, and he wasn't. And when he wasn't there, I called out to Merlin. I said, Merlin, where's Reverend Bradford? She said, I don't know. He didn't call. He didn't do anything. And for some reason, I panicked. And I didn't know what to do because I was so used to him being there every morning, telling me he loved me, telling God loved me, and I didn't see him. And I didn't know what to do. And about that time, the doorbell rang. He came in, sat down, and what a relief. And he told me about Jesus again. I heard him. And he told me about Jesus, and I listened, and I realized, you know, if Jesus can do what Reverend Bradford did for me, if he can come in and soothe my pain and make me feel like I'm worth it, make me feel like, despite what anyone else think, that I'm worth the time of the day, that he would give time of his day to love on me, to make me feel important, like somebody really cared. And he shared Jesus with me, and I heard him that time. And it wasn't smooth, but I continued. I started going to his church. We started things going on at the church, and I still had a lot of issues going on. And some other things happened. I got sick again, and I couldn't do anything once again, and I thought it was over with. And I was watching a TV show, and they started talking about Jesus, and I couldn't turn away from it. And the guy said, why don't you invite him? And I invited him. And I heard this little voice said, you can eat anything you want to eat now. And I knew I couldn't hold anything. And I ordered some food. I was in the hospital, ordered some food. They brought the food in there. It all stayed down. I got out, and I said, I know what I'm supposed to do. And that's been almost 40 years ago, and we haven't looked back, myself or my wife.
Absolutely incredible. Thank you so much for sharing that. Because God has used you since in so many powerful ways, and I don't even have knowledge of the scratching of the surface of what God's been doing in your life since. But I know he's used you to reach a lot of people, and I'm grateful that that you found him and you were receptive when he was there. James, question for you is about, what can I do? What can any individual do? It's kind of two questions. What can a person do, or what can a local church do to help bridge the divide between black and white churches? And so this kind of feeds into my introduction to you about the Church of the Way and what God's laid on your heart. So would you share some of that with us?
Yes. I think I shared this, but I'll share it again. I am amazed that I'm a United Methodist pastor. In that, we have over 800 churches, three of which are black. We have a couple of Latin experiences and a few Asian experiences. And I kept wondering, God, why are you bringing me into that? Because I've been in black church all my life. In my ordination process, I've shared with you about the Christian Community Development Association. Great experience if you want to hear about a great organization. But I went to a worship experience at the Christian Community Development Association where I heard Native Americans worship. And Asian Americans, all in the same church experience. Asian Americans worship and Spanish Americans worship, all in their language and in their experience. And God gave me the vision several years ago that I would pastor a multicultural church. And what I envision is when I think multicultural church is not that there's a dominant culture and this is how you do what we do. You come in, because what I've seen, no offense to any church, is when a white church I've seen say it's multicultural, is you come and do white stuff. Or if you go to a black church, you come and do black stuff. And so my prayer is, God, give me the wisdom to create a true multicultural experience. That means we appreciate each other's culture, each other's language, each other's. We're not trying to say you're less than me because you don't speak the way I do or you worship differently. Now, on this question of what can we do, I'm gonna share something you and I did a few weeks ago, Randy. We kind of slid into a political conversation, but we didn't delve right into it. And I thought, oh God, here we go. This is going to be bad, because we kind of share inadvertently our political views. But what I chose to do was listen. I chose to listen to a different perspective of mine, because I hadn't. I had my political views. I wasn't listening to anybody else. Because I listened because Randy's my friend. And what I found out is we don't have to have the same political views. We have the same Christian perspective, right? And so we didn't end up arguing. I just chose, I'm just going to listen for a minute. Instead of this visceral reaction of, go somewhere with that. And so I'm going to share a couple of things I believe we should do, and I kind of alluded to it, that we should listen to each other, because there's some good there. I was in the Marine Corps 12 years. And whenever we went overseas to another country, they would sit us down, and they would explain the norms of that particular culture. They explain, this is what you do, this is what you don't do if you don't want to offend that culture. Now, I've been to Germany, Norway, Thailand, Korea. I've been all over, and before we went into another space, we've sat down, all of us, so that we can learn not to offend the other culture because we're in their space. So my challenge is take time to learn each other's culture. In seminary, we have internships. You're going to learn to be a good pastor. Go to Pastor Irwin's church and take an internship and learn his culture for several months, and you do that. As a United Methodist pastor, I have learned other cultures by virtue of our cross-cultural appointment. They send in black people and Spanish people into white areas and saying, go learn and be a good pastor. I would challenge Crossroads or anybody that listens to this, go to a black church and live in the space. And you'll find, instead of being afraid of each other, you'll find, wow, I've just made a friend. I share with my previous church, I'm no longer their pastor, but I am their lifelong friend because I got to know them. Mm-hmm. I didn't go try to make African Methodist Episcopal. It's the United Methodist Church. I learned hymns I didn't know before. I learned food I didn't know before. I learned people I didn't know. I'm sitting down with farmers talking about agriculture. Did I say I grew up in St. Louis? Okay, you're right. I didn't know anything about a farm or, crop or rotating crops or anything like that. But I sat down and I met good people. I'm going to laugh about this again. Over a cup of coffee, Pastor Irwin, they would come. When I would go sit at the restaurant, because I became like the town vicar, Pastor James is in the restaurant, yeah. Folks would just sit down and talk. And I used to be afraid of people in overalls and boots, thinking, these are some of the nicest people I've ever met. So to me, take the challenge of going to a Decatur and not just go have one Saturday and say we hung out, but go live in the space and watch how they treat you. Once we get to know you, I'm talking about black folks, you're our friend for life. I found it's the same in everybody else. You can make lifelong friends, but you got to take time to get to in their space. Mm-hmm. That's James's opinion.
Thank you for sharing that. And I just want to, I'm glad you brought that up, because that part of that conversation, I felt some awkwardness with that. The number of people that know my political views, you can count on two hands, because mm-hmm. I'm very private about that. I don't share mm-hmm. those views publicly because they don't define me.
Right.
And they don't define ministry. But the reason I shared them with you, and I, in hindsight, because since you brought it up, mm-hmm. was because I trusted you.
Amen.
I knew that I could mm-hmm. share that. And if we disagreed, we would be okay. And so it was this trust that I have with you as my friend that we can disagree politically and I never think anybody's going to agree with me on that anyway. So I don't go into it with an expectation, right? Amen. Like I'm going to win them over politically. That's not a part of my life mission. And so thank you for listening, and thank you for not judging, and thank you for being the kind of person that I felt like I could trust with that. And we could disagree or not and move on. It wasn't the bulk of our discussion, but it did come up, and I'm glad that it did, because we learned a little more about each other.
We did. And not to suck the conversation up, but I like not having the same people around me that think like me. Mm-hmm. I won't learn without you exposing me to some things.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And why can't we do that more? That's just my prayer. Why can't we just say, let's just talk?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Without
it's,
attacking
It's good
each
when
other.
You can. Pastor Irvin, there, I did some research on this when this thing boiled up here, a few weeks ago, looking at the issue of fatherlessness in homes, and the website that I'd gone to appeared to be credible, and they had all the data and stats going back 10 years, and so the first line was for Caucasian families, and it was 25%. So 25% of white folks in America moms are raising kids without a dad in the home. And I thought, that strikes me as pretty high, because the reason I was doing the research is I had heard somewhere that there was a very high percentage in the black community of dads not engaging with their kids and mother of their kids. And so I didn't know what that percent was. So I saw the Caucasian and it was 25%. And I thought, that's high. And that can impact families. I'd also registered with me that family is God's design, right? Marriage and family came from the Bible from a long, long time ago, and it's His design. And when we do it by the book, so to speak, we have success. So then I go down the list, and there were other listed by races, and I get to African Americans, and it was 70%. 70%. If that number is true, and I've heard it several times repeated and seen it in other studies, fatherless homes. And so I just wanted when we met, you mentioned that, and it sparked my interest in looking up at the information about it. So my questions are, I guess, just to get your response to that, but what effects in any culture, in any subculture, in any society, if you remove the dad from a home to the tune of 7 out of 10 homes has no dad there, and then those kids who are the next generation of dads, those boys who are raised without a dad, and the next generation is without a dad, there's got to be some kind of cultural or societal effect. And so I just want you to, if you can, speak to that, and any ideas you have about, again, how me as an individual person, what could I do if I wanted to do something and step in and try to help a person or a family, where would I start, and how could I begin to help instead of just criticize any group for stats like that?
Yeah. And I don't know how to properly answer that. I do remember once I did a paper on fatherlessness, and for some reason it took me to a situation that was going on around the world, and it was during a period of time when elephants were going nuts. They were killing people. Mm. You may remember it's on the television quite a bit, and some of the crazy things that was going around, the numbers had just skyrocketed, the number of rogue elephants that were killing humans. And so I was, as I followed the article, there was some guy who came in and said he had the answer, and they had tried everything and couldn't figure out what was going on. And this guy's solution was that all these rogue elephants were really basically teenage elephants. They were junior elephants. Mm. He said the problem is that the bull elephants have been killed off and they're not there. He said that if you'll take this reserve, put some bull elephants back in there and just observe what happened. They took the bull elephants, placed them back in the reserve, and after a while things began to settle down. Suddenly, the rogue elephants stopped. Suddenly, the killing of humans stopped. A lot of things that they were doing, destroying crops and things, stopped just by putting the bull elephant there. We've taken the bull elephant out of the families here, but we got this expectation that they can make it, that it'll work, and they're wrong. We need our dads. We need our fathers. We need that example. We need them to give us the hope and challenge us as well. And when you remove those, what's a kid supposed to do? Mm-hmm. You know, particularly if he's got to now figure out life in his own head, and this is how it operates, and this must be the way it is. I've heard others and young folks over the years and listened to them talk, and they've got their philosophy, and it's based upon their experiences. And their experiences have been very negative. What do you expect them to do? They're going to be negative. The answer is, how do we get the fathers once again desiring to be fathers in there? There's something going on where a father wants to leave the home, why the father doesn't want to be a practice, you know, fatherhood. There's something there. Do I know what that is? No. Well, yeah, I do know. And everybody may not agree with me, but I think it's Jesus. I think you can come up with all the studies and everything you want to, but there's something about when you introduce Jesus to a person, particularly to a man, it seems like they take on the responsibility. They step up into leadership roles. There seems to be the vision of wanting to do more. They seem to think in terms of how do we grow. And so for me, if there's an answer, I believe the answer simply is Jesus. And that means, church, what can we do? We can get out and we can begin, have some coffee with young men, have some coffee with fathers. Mm-hmm. And not so much that you bring a whole lot to the table. It's not about trying to correct them. It's about being friends with them and giving them a sense of value. And they will pass that on when they got it. You can't give what you haven't got.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
So they need that. And I think, you know, for a lot of us, we're scared of that kid standing on the street corner with his pants down, and we don't realize he's a father. Mm-hmm. We don't realize that he may have several children out there. That guy makes me nervous. I pull up the stoplight and I hit the button to lock my doors. Mm-hmm. And we're afraid to approach him, but he's a human being. And at one point, there may have been some desire to become someone great, but because of not having everything in place, all the factors there, we got what we see. And now what we want to do is law and order, throw them in jail. And I think if you break the law, you need to go to jail. But I think you also need to try to figure out what's going on here and give them something to shoot for, a goal, some incentive to let them know that this isn't the only way. There is something better. At Restoration, that's the big thing for us, getting fathers to be fathers again, but taking young men and showing them there's a future, there's a hope for you. You ever watched, I don't know if you ever noticed it, but where I grew up in the hood, you'd see this guy on the street corner and he'd be selling drugs or hot items. And this guy could have three or four people standing around him and he's doing business. He says, you owe me this. That's a gram of this and that's this and that. I got this, you know, and he's just doing business with all these folks standing around. And what we're looking at is a corporate executive raw.
Yeah,
who's doing exactly what he know to do because he hasn't been exposed to anything different. And I think that when you give them and let them know the sky's the limit again, I don't see the glass ceiling any longer, and that I can achieve, I can grow. Yes, I recognize it's going to be some hard work, but it's worth the hard work if you show me that I can get there. Mm-hmm. And I think somewhere along the line, you know, that stopped happening.
Amen.
And we're struggling. And as long as we see the negative of everything and we don't begin to vision and dream again, it's not going to get better.
And it's interesting, I think, too, two things. One is that God instituted family.
Yes.
And when we start splitting that up and breaking it up, there are going to be consequences and results of that. But it's interesting to me that the language of family is also the language of church. And so that you are my brother. You know, and so, and you are my brother, and you are my brother, and we yes. use the language of family in church. And so being able to introduce anybody, I mean, this is, I've been on this tirade, if you will, as excited as I get about the Great Commission, that we are to be sharing not only the message of Jesus, but from the heart of Christ, and sharing people the hope and love of God. And so when a young person, black, white, or whatever, but in this case, a black young man, can hear the gospel and can see it lived out and can be engaged with church, we can change a family, a future family. So my conversations with you have only just begun, because I want to take the next step in engaging with you to find, if you can help me find those young men or those young moms who are trying to make it, so that I can personally get involved in being part of the solution, wherever that is. And with James's dedication to a multicultural experience for church, and what you do, I know that I think James had asked you about, do you see color when someone comes to restoration? And you said, I see need.
Yeah.
I see need. I don't see color. And so I want to be part of a solution in my lifetime. I want to, I hope somebody at my funeral is saying, he tried. He tried to make a difference in that problem. And so I feel compelled to be involved in that.
Can I share just briefly on what you said? I know we're kind of running out of time, but what I've found is that when there are not fathers there, that we need to make avail ourselves as men.
Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes.
And I've been blessed to mentor probably about 80 students over the years, because I'm involved in my fraternity on campus, a lot of which come down, and you know they don't have a dad because of their reaction.
Mm. Yeah.
But I think you have to love them enough past that. I had a kid that was still fighting on campus. Mm-hmm. And because we sat down one night and he cried. He cried because he just didn't know what else to do. But I sat with him and talked one night. He eventually got into the MBA program. Because somebody spent some time saying that's not you no more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? And so I think that's also, when you talk about things like that, we have to, as the church, be the church, not just in the walls.
Yes. Right, absolutely.
Yes. That's be the church that's willing to go love people past their hurt. That means you might get hurt.
Yes.
That means you might get hit. That means you might get bit. You know, but at the end of the day, when you see, if you see, like you said, the potential of them, it's worth it. Jesus saw the potential in so many people. How could he call Peter the rock of the church when it took him years to get it right?
He cast a vision for him.
He saw it. I see you beyond what you are today.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I'm no matter what, Peter, the devil is going to sift you.
Yeah.
When you are restored, go do what, Peter? Go restore somebody else.
Yeah.
And that's my prayer when I heard you talking, that we as the church extend ourselves as Jesus did. I got to go to Damascus.
Yeah.
I got to get out of here. I got to go someplace else. Yeah. Y'all too religious.
Well, it reminds me of a book title called Shepherds Smell Like Sheep.
Yeah. I've got to read that.
Yeah. So, you know, how do you know if you're leading people? You're going to be rubbing shoulders and you're going to pick up their smell.
Yes.
I'm going to ask Holden to just lead us briefly into communion. And if you guys would take communion with me, this I think it's wonderful to have coffee and to break bread with your people and those who you don't always agree with or whatever. But man, Jesus gave us this example to bring people to this table and to share this bread and cup. And I just ask Holden to kind of lead us into it. And I'll pass this around and each of you can grab one and we'll take this and maybe Irvin can not be late for his meeting.
Thank you. I'm enjoying this. I may have to get chided a little bit.
Yes.
You know, when it comes to communion, I think one of my favorite aspects of it is the community.
I'm going to steal that.
Yeah. You can't have communion without community, and you can't have community unless you're willing to put yourself out there.
Amen.
You know, and especially with there's lots of hurt going around, mm-hmm. and I think we have to remind ourselves that no matter what situation, we have to be willing to put ourselves out there to be in community. I think one of my favorite analogies for humanity is a bunch of cold hedgehogs, mm-hmm. because the more they want to huddle for warmth, the more they hurt each other. And that, if that's not humanity, I don't know what is, mm-hmm. right? But despite humanity's and its downfalls, Jesus still took 12 disciples, one which he knew was going to make a stupid decision, another one that was going to make several consecutive stupid decisions, and he still broke bread with them, and he said, this is my body broken for you. Mm-hmm. So let's take that right now. And then he follows it up with, you know, the wine, and of course we have grape juice here at Crossroads. But I think, you know, that's, you know, sharing cup with someone, you know, is also something deeply profound, because it gets uncomfortable. I can only imagine, I'm not Catholic, but Catholic communion, they usually share a cup, and that must be awkward at times.
Mm.
And that's life. Life is awkward at times. Praise Jesus passed around and said, "This is my blood shed for you. Let's take it together. Let's pray, if you guys don't mind.
Please.
Dear God, we thank you for community, opportunities for communion. We thank you so much, God, for the Last Supper, because in its reality, it is coarse and harsh. You had the one who would doubt your return, God. You have the one who would renounce you 3 times and the one who betrayed you all in that room. And yet you still chose to have community with them. Help us remember as Christians, no matter how bristly the world may seem, that we go out and we make community with others. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And all my brothers said, amen.
Amen.
Thank you guys so much.
Every head that's on my head, every time I lift my head. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Jesus, your name above all names, God. Your name is beautiful. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. The silence that the heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You had no rival, you had no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. For yours is
yours is the kingdom. Yours is